I once heard Elder Jeffrey R. Holland say that in this church we should probably sing a lot more and talk a lot less. And I think we were just shown why he said that. I hope I don't show why he said that as well. Thank you for coming tonight. Thank you for supporting the religion department here at BYU. Those of you members of the community, we extend a special welcome to you. Thank you for supporting us and coming onto campus and hobnobbing with these youngsters and putting up with them. Thank you for joining with us. I've seen a lot of my students. I have almost 1,000 students at BYU this semester, and I've seen quite a few of them here. They're not getting extra credit for that, which they're probably disappointed in. But I do want to thank them for coming and supporting me. They hear from me twice a week already, and here they are tonight. So I will pray for them. I will pray for their grades, that if any of their grades are like Lazarus, that the Lord will bring them back in the next 2 weeks. I'm honored to share the stage tonight, the podium tonight, with Sister Olson and President Worthen. I look up to them both so much, I don't feel adequate being here, but I'm grateful to be here. And I hope what I say tonight might be a good preparation for our hearts and minds to be taught from them. I know I'm excited to learn from them, and I'm excited that I get to be done when I hear them speak. My remarks tonight, I decided to focus on a statement made by the prophet Joseph Smith. If you can picture this in your mind, it was in Nauvoo. The temple was not complete. Just off to the side of the temple site, the temple construction site, a group of saints had gathered to hear from the prophet. It was Sunday, March 20th, 1842. The prophet had intended to speak on the doctrine of baptism. But just a few days earlier, a young toddler had died. 2-year-old Marion Lyon. And so the prophet altered his remarks to include his thoughts on death and resurrection. And then he made this statement, and this is where I'm focusing on tonight. He said, "We mourn the loss, but we do not mourn as those without hope." I think what the prophet was saying is we, as Latter-day Saints, we do mourn, but we mourn differently than do others because of what we know. One might say we mourn with hope. And that is my subject tonight, the idea of mourning with hope. Everyone here, in some way, has experienced what the scriptures call the sting of death. I bet in your mind you can recall the voice or the laughter of those you have loved who have died. I bet you can still recall the smile of a loved one who has passed on. Despite the time that has gone by, in a still moment, I bet you still hear their voice echoing across your memory. A voice of a person we long to see again, to talk to again, to laugh with again. I can still remember my grandmother, my grandma Smith, who passed away when I was just graduated from high school. I can still hear her voice if I close my eyes and hear her say, "Oh, I love you too, dear." And I bet you can as well. I bet if I had you close your eyes for a moment, you could still hear the voice of a cherished mother or father, maybe a spouse, a child, a friend. And in those moments, we feel wonderful because of the memory, but we also feel the heartache that comes from, again, what the scriptures call the sting of death. Ralph Waldo Emerson said, now I'm going to show some quotes here. He said, "Sorrow makes us all children again. It destroys all differences of intellect. The wisest know nothing." Think of the times in your life where you have grieved the loss of someone you have loved. I don't want to beleaguer your memories on that. However, I want those of you who haven't experienced it, perhaps you're a little young and you still think that tragedy is not going to hit your life. I remember when I thought that as well, that tragedy always happened to someone else. And it never happened to my family. And how sad it was that it happened to others' family. But then, who remembers the day the dial of tragedy landed on your family? So I wanted to share with you some comments from an internet forum where someone came on and asked a question. They said, how am I supposed to deal with this? I think someone very close to them had just died. And I want to share with you a couple of the responses from those who just decided to make their feelings public on this internet forum. A woman said, there are no words, not enough tears to reflect the immensity of our loss. Everything is changed. A thief has robbed me of my future. The space she inhabited in our lives has become a void where her laughter and light no longer lives, where questions remain unanswered. Another person wrote, I cannot describe how the loss affects you physically, emotionally, and spiritually, every way possible. I only know that it did. My whole body ached with sorrow. I didn't think it was possible to cry that much, but I did. I didn't think it was possible to be sad and miss someone so much, but I did. And another, the first few days, this person writes, were a surreal nightmare. I actually asked people to wake me up. Then I just started putting one foot in front of the other and walking through all the logistics of death and learning to be alone. I live in a wide awake coma. I'm here, walking, talking, writing, but not really here at all. All the meaning of life was drained from me in that one horrible moment. You can see now why the prophet would have said, we mourn, but we do not mourn as those without hope. This is a philosopher based out of Cambridge. His name is Stephen Cave. He doesn't have the light of the gospel in his life. He wrote, we have to live in the knowledge that the worst thing that can possibly happen one day surely will. The end of our projects, our hopes, our dreams, our individual world. We live in the shadow of a personal apocalypse, and that's frightening. It's terrifying. Another who believes that way is a novelist by the name of Howard Jacobson. He wrote, how do you ever go on knowing that you will never, not ever, ever see the person you have loved? How do you survive a single hour, a single minute, a single second of that knowledge? How do you hold yourself together? You can hear the pain and sorrow in even ancient writing. The poet Euripides wrote, come back, even as a shadow, even as a dream. There are those, in doing the research for this message, there are those I found who try to sidestep death entirely. These are two corporate executives by the name of Larry Ellison and Larry Page, who, between the two of them, have spent, and I got this number right, I checked it, $1.1 billion just between the two of them on anti-aging research. They don't want to die. One of them told his biographer, how can a person be there and just vanish and just not be there? Others have taken a more lighthearted approach. I hesitate to show you this. One of my good friends is John Hilton, and he teaches here at BYU, and I was kind of discussing with him this morning, how much of these pictures should I show? And he said, oh, I don't know. So I'll try to toe the line here and watch for your reaction. The first I want to show you is Billy Stanley of Mechanicsburg, Idaho, who decided to purchase 3 burial plots so he could be buried in a large plexiglass casket where his body would sit atop his 1967 Harley-Davidson. Okay, that went okay. Let's go with another one. The next one I want to show you is George Swanson of Hempfield County, Pennsylvania, who purchased 12 burial plots so he could be buried in the driver's seat of his 1984 white Corvette, which only had 27,000 miles on it. I know. You have to wonder if in the resurrection the Lord's going to let them drive those out of the ground, right? How about this one? The family of a Pittsburgh Steelers fan, James Smith, transformed the funeral home with a small stage and furniture into Smith's living room. The deceased was placed in his favorite recliner, remote control in hand, so he could comfortably watch a loop of the Steelers playing football on TV. Humor is a way that some people deal with death. Actor Woody Allen said, I'm not afraid to die. I just don't want to be there when it happens. Winston Churchill took it stoically. He said, I am prepared to meet my maker. Whether my maker is prepared for that great ordeal of meeting me is another matter. It's a very self-inflated sense of self. How about the Malagasy people in Madagascar? Every year, these people have what is called the turning of the bones, in which they unbury all of their dead loved ones, redress them, dance with them, and then rebury them. At times, there's not enough to dance with, and so they wrap the bones in a canvas bag and pass them around the crowd. This is the one that John told me not to show you, so I'm not going to, but if you ever want to look this one up, look up the Tarajan people on the Indonesian island of Sulawesi. The death of the family member for these people is not an abrupt final severing event like it is for us. Instead, death is just one step in a long, gradual unfolding process. Why? Because the bodies of their deceased loved ones stay in the home. They stay in the home, they are dressed, sit at meals, and even are part of family pictures for weeks, months, or even years following death. And I need to skip that picture. Most others deal with death in a much more traditional, private way. Many turn to mourning in private, as you have done. When Madame Marie Curie's husband was killed in an accident, she walked home quietly, draped in black, and then wrote in her diary, "They filled the grave and put sheaves of flowers on it. Everything is over. Pierre is sleeping his last sleep beneath the earth. It is the end of everything. Everything. Everything." I would love to tell you, perhaps I wouldn't, but that the faithful are exempt from grief. But as I've thought about it, I don't think that faith was meant to erase grief. Grief is a form of love. Think of the heartache of one Stillman Pond. It's difficult for me to even tell this story. Stillman and his wife Maria joined the church in 1841. The Ponds were among the first group to flee Nauvoo in the February of 1846. And later that year in Winter Quarters, Nebraska, the saints were ravaged by malaria, cholera, and consumption. It was there that this man, Stillman Pond, buried 9 of his 11 children and his sweet wife, Maria. That is almost unfathomable. More recently, we remember President Hinckley when he went through the loss of his wife, Marjorie. He said, "Before I married her, she had been the girl of my dreams," to use the words of a song then popular. "She was my dear companion for more than 2/3 of a century, my equal before the Lord, really my superior. And now in my old age, she has again become the girl of my dreams." Recently, in my Book of Mormon class, we studied 3 Nephi. And we went through the darkness that plagued the Nephites in 3 Nephi chapter 8, where in the old world, the Savior was killed and buried. Here in the new world were 3 days of darkness. When they were encompassed in this overwhelming darkness, in fact, I asked my students, I said, how long do you think before you would go insane? How long could you be in total darkness before you would start to hallucinate and start to scream and wail? Because it's described as mourning and howling and weeping in 3 Nephi chapter 8. Somewhere towards the end of those 3 days, though, they heard a voice. And amid that message, they heard, "I am Jesus Christ, the Son of God. I am the light," which is what they wanted most, right? "I am the light and the life of the world." The Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer, our brother and friend, turns death into life, darkness into light, and mourning into joy. His entire existence witnesses that the reality that death is not the end. Like the first glimmer of dawn turns a glorious morning sun, after the darkest and coldest of nights, he has gloriously risen as the supreme embodiment of light and life. Weeping does endure for a night, but joy does come with the rising sun. I was in with my New Testament class this week, and we're talking about the resurrection. Here we are towards the end of the semester, so we're talking about the resurrection. And I got quoted on Twitter, which I was happy to note, as saying in my class, "A belief in the resurrection changes everything." And it does. A belief in the resurrection means a completely different life than those who do not believe in life after death. It is a great sift. When you believe in the hope and glory of a resurrection, you live differently. You act differently. You mourn differently. In fact, G. Stanley Hall, American psychologist, he noted this. Look at this, what he wrote. "The most essential claim of Christianity is to have removed the fear of death and made the king of terrors into a good friend and boon companion." The resurrection of Jesus Christ is the very core of who we are as a church and who we are as disciples of Christ. In the Bible Dictionary, we read that Christianity is founded upon the greatest of all miracles, the resurrection of our Lord. If that be admitted, other miracles cease to be improbable. I told my students just this week, if you believe in the resurrection, what else can this man do? Surely you don't put bounds on a man who has broken the bonds of death, who can come and go from the planet at will. Surely you're telling me he can't reveal a book to a 14-year-old boy? He can't put a man inside a fish for 3 days? Sure he can. He can do anything. He brought himself back from the dead. There are those who will scoff and will say that the resurrection is simply foolish in an enlightened world. But I love what E.F. Schumacher once wrote. He said, "The modern world seems to be skeptical about everything that demands that makes demands on man's higher faculties. But it is not at all skeptical about skepticism, which demands hardly anything." I believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I believe in what Abinadi said, quote, "There is a resurrection. The grave hath no victory, and the sting of death is swallowed up in Christ. He is the light and life of the world, a light that is endless, that can never be darkened, a life that is endless, that there can be no more death." That is why Easter today, Good Friday, and Easter Sunday is so significant to us. Because a belief in the resurrection changes everything. Listen to this poem. It was unknown to me before I found it. I wonder if anyone here has heard it. It's from Eliza R. Snow, where she wrote a poem to death itself. She says, "The darkness that encompassed thee is gone. There is no frightfulness about thee now. Since the glorious light of revelation shone upon thy path, thou seemest no more a hideous monster, armed with, as thou art, by inspiration's light, thou hast no look the righteous need to fear." I'm a big fan of the springtime, not just because I grew up in St. George, where we had perpetual springtime, but because springtime is, to me, a witness of the resurrection. Martin Luther said, "Our Lord has written the promise of the resurrection, not in books alone, but in every leaf." In springtime, think of all those witnesses that we are seeing across our land just today, the witnesses of the resurrection. Wrote Philip Brooks, "Let every man and woman count himself immortal." I don't know if you've ever thought about that, but when you wake up in the morning and look in the mirror, please remember you're looking at an immortal being. Let him catch the revelation of Jesus in his resurrection. Let him say not merely Christ is risen, but I shall rise. Without any doubt, without any uncertainty, we, as Christ's followers, declare each individual will see, hear, talk, and laugh with, embrace their cherished loved ones again. That kind mother, your gentle father, your grandparents, siblings, a wife, a husband, your best of friends, all will live again. Brothers and sisters, is there any more important message in all the world? The certainty of the resurrection is the only force able to mitigate the shock and bereavement of losing a beloved family member or friend to death. No matter where we search for peace, every other source will cease to make us whole. While the deep pain of loss and trauma of a changed daily life is not taken away, the surety of the resurrection of Jesus Christ can calm the stormy seas. We are bereaved. But such grief is, mercifully, temporary. Because of Jesus Christ, even the darkest night will end and the sun will rise. Our knowledge of the plan of salvation, the fall of man, the role of death, and the atonement of Jesus Christ enable us to do what Joseph said. It enables us to mourn with hope. To finish, I thought instead of talking about mourning with hope, I might give you an example. I met the happiest person I'd ever met in my life around 19 years ago. He still, after those 19 years, is the happiest man I've ever met. And not the overbearing happy, the uplifting happy. Do you have anyone in your life who you just feel good when they're around? You feel better about yourself and your life and the future? That's this kind of man. He went through a difficult time recently, and so I asked him a little bit if I might be able to share this story at our event tonight, and he said I could. So I'm going to give you a little bit of background. He grew up in a little town called Richfield, Utah. It's in the 1950s. Everything was in black and white back then. I've seen the pictures. He said he often went over to the Richfield Dairy to get penny candy. For those college students who don't know what penny candy is, come up and talk to me. It's in the same era as when we used to attach phones to the house. It's primitive. He said he'd go there to get penny candy. His dad would often send him there with his little brother to go get penny candy. And he said one day when I was at the Richfield Dairy, the little door, the bell on the door rang, and I looked over to see who had come in. And he said, a little girl about my age. He said, she fascinated me. He said, I'd seen her before, but never really looked at her. And here she walked in. She had new clothes on. And he said, I was deeply fascinated. I said, what'd you do? He said, I stared at her. Here he is, 7, 8, maybe 9 years old, and he's staring at this little girl. I said, did she know she was being stared at? He said, oh, yes. But she wasn't about to take a look over. She went up and very properly picked out her candy and walked out the door. Later, he got in the car. His mom was waiting for him, and she said, it must have been noticeable, because she said, who is that little girl you were studying in there? And he said, I wasn't studying anyone. And she said, well, it seemed to me like you were studying someone. And he said, Hank, I kept my eye on her, that little girl, all through school. She didn't know who I was, but I kept my eye on her. And he said, one day my school counselor told me, you ought to take someone to junior prom. He said, I don't go to junior prom. I'm going hunting. And the counselor said, that's too bad. I think every girl deserves to go to junior prom. And he said, oh, I'd never thought of it that way. Most boys don't. He said, I thought, well, who would I ask? And then he thought, I know who I'll ask. I'll ask the little girl from the candy store. And he already knew her name by then, and so he called her up, and this man's name is Rod, and he called up Marlene, the little girl from the candy store, and he said, Marlene, this is Rod Savage. Savage is a name now that my students use for cool. It's quite odd. But that is really his last name. He says, this is Rod Savage. Would you like to go to junior prom with me? And he said, she was speechless. And I talked to her later, and she said, I didn't know who he was. And so he's on the phone to asking me out, I'm flipping through the yearbook as fast as I can to try to find out who this boy is. She's asking her mom, do you know who this is? And her mom says, I don't know. Right? And she said, well, sure, I'd love to go to prom with you. This was back in the day where you didn't have to spend $5,000 to ask someone a junior prom. She said, I'd love to go with you. And he said, that's wonderful. And he hung up. And she said, I had to search for him to get some details at school. later that week. He told me later, he said, something magical happened at that prom. He said, she got me to think about the future. He said, I'd never thought 2 weeks passed into the future. She was very serious, very astute. She was National Honor Society president, and she took her grades very seriously. Rod said, grades were the thing that got in the way of having fun. My students know exactly how that feels. He said, you know, we never went on another date with anyone else ever again. Just out of high school, they were married. They moved to a little town called St. George, Utah, like I said, where I grew up, and they started a family. And Rod still himself, still very much outgoing and gregarious and a little bit crazy. And Marlene's still very much herself, serious, cautious. But they make a good pair. They complement each other very well. Well, when they brought their first little baby home, baby Justin, their oldest, Rod thought it would be fun to take the 2-year-old newborn on a tour of the house. And so he said, Marlene, let's take Justin on a tour of the house. She said, he's 2 days old and he's asleep. Doesn't matter. Let's go on a tour of the house. So she took him on a tour. He took the baby, he took him on a tour. He said, this is the piano. This is the painting. Every little thing. As Marlene told me, this tour took over 2 hours. It was a 2-bedroom apartment, right? But he went to every faucet. And little silly things like that, I bet it's happened in your family. They become a tradition. And so when baby Amy came, 2-year-old Justin in tow with Marlene, baby Amy got a tour of the house with everybody right behind. And then when the third child came, baby Colton, he got a tour of the house. Then baby Josh, he got a tour of the house. And then their fifth child, their most perfect child, my wife Sarah, she got a tour of the house. And then their sixth child, their last baby, baby Katie, she got a tour of the house with the entire family in tow. But unfortunately, the tour had to be canceled because Marlene wasn't about to have any more children. And it was about 15 years later when they had a grandbaby. And everyone rejoiced because it was the return of the tour, and everyone was there, including in-laws now. And I was there for the tour of the first baby. And I turned to my wife and I said, what in the world are we doing? And she said, it's what we do. Go with it. And we went to every bathroom and looked at every faucet. And pretty soon people start drifting away from the tour. And there's grandpa and grandma and grandchild dutifully going to every little piece of the house to get a tour. He would use it as a teaching tool. He would turn my nephew to me and say, this is your Uncle Hank. Uncle Hank's going to take good care of you, aren't you, Uncle Hank? Yes, sir. I still text that boy. He's 18, and I say, how are you? And he says, why do you text me? I said, it was on the tour. All of my 5 children have been on the tour, including my twin boys, who got a double tour as they went through the house. About 4 years ago, as Sarah and I were out at a restaurant with our children celebrating a birthday, we got a phone call. And there are phone calls that change your life forever. You've had them, and if you haven't, you will. Marlene called with courage and faith to tell us that at 64 years of age, she had stage 4 liver cancer. That the doctors told her she didn't have long to live. And they were right. 10 months later, she was on hospice care. At 66. So she must have been 65 when she was diagnosed. My wife was there the weekend her mother passed away. I stayed at home to take care of the children. In fact, my mother-in-law's last thought of me, the last conversation about me was she grabbed my wife's hand and said, Sarah, I'm so sorry you have to be here. Where are your children? And she said, it's okay, Mom. I want to be here. They're home with Hank. To which my mother-in-law responded, oh. My wife said that the night she passed away, the hospice nurse came over to Rod and said, "Rod, judging by Marlene's vital signs, it's going to be soon. I suggest we get her out of her wheelchair and into bed." And he said, "Okay." And as he's wheeling her wheelchair back to her room for the last time, my wife said he stopped. And he asked the hospice nurse something, and the nurse said, "Of course." And he turned to his children and he said, "Let's take Mom on one last tour." And my wife said they went to the living room. And he said, "Marlene," he grabbed her hand and he knelt in front of her and he said, "47 years of family home evening. How did you put up with us?" And then he took her into the family room and he knelt in front of her and he said, "How many shows have we watched together, Marlene? How many hours have I rubbed your feet? How many John Wayne movies have you put up with?" Took one into the kitchen, he knelt in front of her and he said, "47 years of meals. You're the greatest cook that's ever lived." My wife said, "I saw my mother visibly smile as if to say, you liar." And then the children drifted off as he took her to the family pictures. And they talked about each child and each grandchild and the effort and time she had put in to raising this family. And then my wife said, "I saw my father pick up his bride and gently lay her in bed for the last time, where he knelt holding her hand for the next 6 hours, talking with her, rubbing her head until she peacefully passed away. I said, 'What were you thinking?' He said, 'Oh, I didn't want her last day to be sad.' And he said, 'I didn't want her to be scared.'" Mourning with hope means celebrating time spent in mortality with those we love. It means looking forward with anticipation to joyful reunions. Mourning with hope means placing all your hope, all your power in the Lord Jesus Christ, trusting in him that he will return those you love and you to your heavenly home. It means acting in faith upon the commandments until you regain the presence and behold the face of your heavenly parents. When I leave this frail existence, when I lay this mortal by, Father, Mother, may I meet you in your royal courts on high. Then at length, when I've completed all you sent me forth to do, with your mutual approbation, let me come and dwell with you." Rod and Marlene, in the name of Jesus Christ, amen.